Is mind control by cell phone possible? Hospitals and airplanes ban the use of cell phones because their electromagnetic transmissions can interfere with sensitive electrical devices. Could the brain also fall into that category? Of course, all our thoughts, sensations, and actions arise from bioelectricity generated by neurons and transmitted through complex neural circuits inside our skull. Electrical signals between neurons generate electrical fields that radiate out of brain tissue as electrical waves that can be picked up by electrodes touching a person's scalp. Measurements of such brain waves in EEGs provide powerful insight into a brain's function and a valuable diagnostic tool for doctors. Indeed, so fundamental are brain waves to the internal workings of the mind, they have become the ultimate legal definition drawing the line between life and death. But scientists can do more with brain waves than just listen in on the brain at work. They can selectively control brain function by transcranial magnetic stimulation, TMS. This technique uses powerful pulses of electromagnetic radiation beamed into a person's brain to jam or excite particular brain circuits. Although a cell phone is much less powerful than TMS, the question still remains. Could the electrical signals coming from a phone affect certain brain waves operating in resonance with cell phone transmission frequencies? After all, the caller's cerebral cortex is just centimeters away from radiation broadcast from the phone's antenna. Two studies provide some revealing news. The first, led by Rodney Croft of the Brain Science Institute, Swinburne University Technology, tested whether cell phone transmissions could alter a person's brain waves. The researchers monitored the brain waves of 120 healthy men and women while a Nokia 6110 cell phone, one of the most popular cell phones in the world, was strapped to their head. A computer controlled the phone's transmissions in a double-blind experimental design, which meant that neither the test subject nor researchers knew whether the cell phone was transmitting or idle while EEG data were collected. The data showed that when the cell phone was transmitting, the power of a characteristic brainwave pattern called alpha waves in the person's brain was boosted significantly. The increased alpha wave activity was greatest in brain tissue directly beneath to the cell phone, strengthening the case that the phone was responsible for the observed effect. Alpha waves of brain. Alpha waves fluctuate at a rate of 8 to 12 cycles per second, hertz. These brain waves reflect a person's state of arousal and attention. Alpha waves are generally regarded as an indicator of reduced mental effort, known as cortical idling or mind wandering. But this conventional view is perhaps an oversimplification. Croft, for example, argues that the alpha wave is really regulating the shift of attention between external and internal inputs. Alpha waves increase in power when a person shifts his or her thoughts of the external world to internal ones. They also are the key brainwave signatures of sleep. Cell phone insomnia. If cell phone signals boost a person's alpha waves, does this nudge them subliminally into an altered state of awareness or have any effect at all on the workings of their mind that can be observed in a person's behavior? In the second study, James Horn and colleagues at the Loughborough University Sleep Research Center in England devised an experiment to test this question. The result was surprising. Not only could the cell phone signals alter a person's behavior during the call, the effects of the disrupted brainwave patterns continued long after the phone was switched off. According to Horn, this was a completely unexpected finding. They did not suspect any effect on EEG after switching off the phone. They were interested only in studying the effects of mobile phone signals on sleep itself. But it quickly became obvious to Horn and colleagues in preparing for the sleep research experiments that some of the test subjects had difficulty falling asleep. Horn and his colleagues controlled a Nokia 6310E cell phone, another popular and basic phone, attached to the head of 10 healthy but sleep-deprived men in their sleep research lab. Their sleep had been restricted to 6 hours the previous night. The researchers then monitored the men's brainwaves by EEG, while the phone was switched on and off by remote computer, and also switched between standby, listen, and talk modes of operation for 30-minute intervals on different nights. The experiment revealed that after the phone was switched to talk mode, a different brainwave pattern called delta waves in the range of 1 to 4 hertz remained dampened for nearly 1 hour after the phone was shut off. These brainwaves are the most reliable and sensitive marker of stage 2 sleep. Approximately 50% of total sleep consists of this stage, and the subjects remained awake twice as long after the phone transmitting in talk mode was shut off. Although the test subjects had been sleep deprived the night before, they could not fall asleep for nearly 1 hour after the phone had been operating without their knowledge. The significance of the research, Horn explained, is that although the cell phone power is low, electromagnetic radiation can nevertheless have an effect on mental behavior when transmitting at the proper frequency. He finds this fact especially remarkable when considering that everyone is surrounded by electromagnetic clutter radiating from all kinds of electronic devices in our modern world. Cell phones in talk mode seem to be particularly well tuned to frequencies that affect brainwave activity. The results show sensitivity to low-level radiation to a subtle degree. These findings open the door by a crack for more research to follow. One can only speculate if with different doses, durations, or other devices, if there would be greater effects.